So what are the types of faults that we encounter usually? We encounter open circuit faults, short circuit faults, and other types of faults. So open circuit fault, we have already seen there are two types of open circuit faults. Suppose in a three-phase conductor, if one conductor gets open circuited and the remaining two conductors are intact, then it is called single line open circuit fault. Similarly, if two conductors are open out of three conductors, it can be in a transmission line, it can be in a feeder, it can be in a transformer, anywhere. If two conductors are open circuited, then it is called double line open circuit fault. Understand? What are the reasons for these open circuit faults? The jumpers that are connecting one tower to other tower, they may get disconnected. In hot summer season, they absorb huge heat, so the thermal expansion will be more. Sometime at more tension, they may get cut. Understand? So due to uneven expansion and contraction, due to seasonal changes also, the jumpers may get cut. Second one is damaging of circuit breaker poles. So circuit breaker will close, but out of three contacts, one contact will not be proper because of the mechanical damage of the fixed and moving contacts. So these two are the main reasons why the open circuit faults will occur. One is breakdown of jumpers. The second one is damage of circuit breaker poles. Okay. What are the effects of open circuit fault? Open circuit faults are characterized by increase in voltage and reduction in current. So definitely, when open circuit occurs, in the remaining phases, what will happen? The voltage will increase, the current will reduce. Understand? The other is loss of supply to consumers. The consumers who are connected to the disconnected phase, they will not get the supply. All three-phase induction motors, they operate on two phases, that is called single phasing. Single phasing will damage the motor. Understand? So overvoltages, if the overvoltage magnitude is high, then it may cause the insulation failure of the electrical equipment. So these are the effects or disadvantages of the open circuit faults. Okay. Next, short circuit faults. So there are five types of short circuit faults. We have already seen LG fault, LL fault, LLG fault, triple L and triple LG fault. Okay. So why the short circuit faults occur? Due to atmospheric conditions, due to excessive heating, due to aging of the equipment, and due to insulation failure. Out of this, the most common reason is failure of insulation. So because of these reasons, the short circuit faults will occur. Understand? Now, other types of faults which does not classify into open circuit and short circuit faults are overspeed and underspeed of alternator, loss of prime mover of alternator, loss of excitation of alternator, unbalanced loading on the alternator, overheating of alternator, or it can be overheating of transformer, okay, oil leakage in transformer. Like this, variety of faults will be there which does not classify in this one. The other one is loss of magnetic flux inside the core. So all these types of faults, all the other types of faults, understand, which does not classify under open circuit and short circuit faults, they fall in this category. Okay. So any doubts so far?
No.
What are the effects of short circuit faults? So short circuit faults are characterized by decrease in voltage and increase in current. Decrease in voltage and increase in current. Fault currents are, during short circuit, the fault currents are 2 to 10 times full load currents. 2 to 10 times full load currents. Power factor of the short circuit fault is, in ideal, that means if you completely neglect resistance, it is ZPF lag. If you consider the resistance, it will be in the range of 0.1 lag. The nature of fault current is purely, mainly inductive. The fault current is mainly contributed by synchronous motors and synchronous generators. So both the synchronous motors and synchronous generators are the sources for fault current. Are the sources for fault current. Understand? So, as the power system equipment carry fault currents in the range of 2 to 10 times the full load currents, as power system equipment carry fault currents in the range of 2 to 10 times the full load currents, the excessive heat generated due to I square R losses and huge magnetic forces of attraction or repulsion occur. So, because of the high fault currents, there is an enormous amount of heat is generated and huge magnetic forces of attraction or repulsion depending upon the current direction occurs. The equipments are not designed to withstand these thermal and mechanical stresses. The equipment are not designed to withstand these thermal and mechanical stresses. So, causing permanent damage to equipment, if the fault is not cleared before the withstand time of the equipment, before the withstand time of the equipment, then there will be a permanent damage to the equipment. There will be permanent damage to the equipment. Understand? So, what is this withstand time? Every equipment has some short time rating. The amount of time for which it can carry the fault current without getting damaged. So usually if you see your circuit breaker in your home connected to AC, at the bottom where you can see either 10,000 ampere or 6,000 ampere, that is the breaking current. That means it can clear the fault up to that 6000 ampere. Now there is one more rating that is called short time rating or withstand time of that circuit breaker, which is usually either 1 second or 3 seconds. That means it can withstand that 6000 amperes of current only for 1 second or at max for 3 seconds. If that 6000 ampere current flows through that circuit breaker for more than 1 second, the circuit breaker itself permanently gets damaged. So, every equipment will have certain short time rating for which it can carry the short circuit currents. Usually it will be 1 second, 2 second or 3 second. If you don't clear the short circuit fault within this time, that equipment will get permanently damaged. Okay. So, out of 100 short circuit faults, 80% short circuit faults are transient or momentary in nature. They come, they go. So, momentary, they will get their self-clearing. So, 80% of short circuit faults are self-clearing. Okay. Why? Because suppose there is a 33 kV line, suddenly one bird sits on R phase and Y phase. Because it doesn't know. One leg it will keep on R phase, the other leg it keeps on Y phase. So immediately next moment the short circuit happens, the bird dies and it will fall onto the ground. So what happened? Fault occurred, breaker trips, again the fault is self-cleared. That bird will fall onto the ground after getting shocked, the fault is cleared. Or for example, a big branch of a tree, due to heavy wind, it will come and touch the two lines or three lines and immediately it goes back. So likewise, most of the faults in power system are transient in nature. They come and they go. Most of the times we don't know the reason why it has also happened. Okay. But permanent short circuit faults are only 20%. They are mainly due to insulation breakdown. So 20% of times the short circuit faults are permanent. They are caused by insulation failure of any one of the equipment. So when a permanent short circuit fault occurs, the breaker will trip the fault, but again to make the system healthy, it will take some time. It will take some days or some months sometimes to rectify the issue. Okay. Next, how relay and circuit breaker will coordinate with each other? Okay. So relay is an element that detects the fault condition, that detects the fault or abnormal condition in the system and gives a tripping command to the circuit breaker. Suppose the red line, the red conductor is the one which we are protecting. So we are protecting this, the conductor that is red conductor. As long as it carries normal current, let us assume the CT ratio is 500/5. That means if the red conductor carries 500 ampere, the CT will carry 5 ampere. Okay. So we have said that any current above 1000 ampere is a fault current for us. So the threshold limit I have set is 1000 amperes. Okay. So whenever 1000 amperes flow through this red conductor because of some fault, how much current is flowing? 1000 amperes is flowing, let us say. Or say 1500 amperes is flowing. Okay. Then how much current will flow in the CT secondary? The ratio is 500/5. So if 500 goes in the primary, CT will carry 5 ampere. If 1500 goes, it will carry how much? 15 ampere. I have kept my relay setting such that any current above 10 ampere, it will give trip command. Since now my current is 15 ampere, this immediately relay senses this abnormal condition, then it closes this contact. It closes the contact in the trip circuit of circuit breaker. This is the trip circuit of circuit breaker. So once this contact is closed, the trip coil of the circuit breaker gets supply from this DC source or battery. Then immediately what happens? Here you can observe, when it is operating, this contact will be in contact with this one. It will be like this. It will be closing like this when it is in healthy condition. So whenever this trip coil gets energized, it will pull this to this direction. So what will happen? Then it will, the moving contact gets back and it opens the conductor. Understand? So relay detects the abnormal condition and gives tripping command to the circuit breaker. When circuit breaker receives the trip command from the relay, it opens the contacts and isolate the fault. Once you open this one, this is the source side and this is the fault, and you open this breaker, so this is, this connection is gone, so fault is isolated. So this diagram will tell you how the coordination occurs between the relay and the circuit breaker. It is just a mechanical explanation. Nowadays, modern relays are all DSP processor based, microprocessor based. So, just to explain this, we have taken this structure. okay, this is how the relay and the circuit breaker gets coordinated. So there we have shown the only one phase. Usually every phase has one CT and all these CTs are connected to a common relay. So this relay senses the abnormal condition whenever the current exceeds certain limit, and then it will issue trip command to the circuit breaker. So this is a three pole circuit breaker, and this is a relay, and this is the trip circuit of circuit breaker. So simply it will make one contact, it will close one contact and energizes the trip circuit of the circuit. Why protection is required and what is the major objective of protection? Okay, a protection system is designed for continuous monitoring of power system. It should ensure maximum continuity of service with minimum damage to life, equipment and property. Understand? So what is the major objective of designing switchgear, designing the protection system? The protection system should be designed such that it should ensure maximum supply continuity to the customers. Customers should not be affected, at least those customers in whose area there is no fault, they should not be affected. And it should also ensure safety of human life, equipment safety and safety of the property. Understand? Because power system equipments are very costly, they involve crores of money. So out of the total investment, only 5% is invested on protection switchgear. This 5% equipment will protect 95% equipment. This 5% switchgear will protect the 95% of power system equipment. Understand? Sir, why we are ensuring the minimum damage to life, equipment and property? 90 to 95% of fire accidents happens because of electrical short circuit. All over the world, 90 to 95% fire accidents happen because of electrical short circuit. Do you know who will get suffered? In an electrical short circuit, more than the electrical equipment, the public property gets damaged. So if you clear the fault immediately, then what happens? We can prevent the damage to life, equipment and public property. So your switchgear design, the protection system should be designed with these objectives. Understand? So electrical short circuit, in most of the cases, public property gets damaged. So you have to design the protection system such that it ensures first objective is maximum continuity. The customers should not be suffered, at least those customers in whose area the fault is not there, they should get the continuous supply. Minimum equipment should be isolated. The fault must be cleared such that only minimum breakers are tripped. So minimum breakers are tripping, isolating the fault, then maximum people will get the supply. Second point. And we have to make sure that human life, power system equipment like our transformers, generators, transmission lines, everything is safe, and even public property is safe. Are you able to understand, gentlemen? Hello? Okay. So what are the features of protection system? How you should design the protection system? Speed, sensitivity, selectivity, reliability, simplicity and economical. The protection system should have all these features. It should have all these features. Okay. So what is sensitivity? A protective relay. Relay is the one who who never sleeps. Relay is always checking the condition. It is always checking whether the fault is happening or not. Matlab, it is always hunting for any abnormal situation. So relay never sleeps. Understand? Circuit breaker is always sleeping. So whenever relay senses the abnormal condition, only when the relay gives the tripping command, then only circuit breakers will act. Understand? So relay is the one who is always active, who is always sensing for the abnormal condition. So a protective relay should be able to detect even smallest of the fault current in its zone. That means it should be very clear about the fault. Whenever the threshold is crossed, when I set 100 ampere is any current above 100 is a fault current, even for 100.01, it should start acting. It should start acting. That feature is called sensitivity. That feature is called sensitivity. The relay should be sensitive. Gentlemen, I am telling you, for one fault to other fault, many times some years will pass. Suppose the breaker tripped in 1990, the other fault came in 2005. The other fault came in 15 years gap between one fault and another fault. Suppose when the fault comes, if your relay does not function, then what is the purpose? The purpose is completely defeated. Understand? So there may be a years of gap between one fault to the other fault, but your protection system should reliably function. Understand? Sensitivity means the relay should be able to sense even the smallest and smallest value of fault currents. Okay. The last topic for today's lecture is protective zones. Protective zones. If you see this figure, in order to limit the number of devices, the entire protection scheme is divided into different zones. That means this is one zone, this generator and transformer is one zone, this transmission line is one zone, this transmission line is one zone, okay, this is one more zone. And this is one. How many zones are there here? Six different zones are there. Six different zones are there. Okay. So, circuit breaker 1 is protecting any fault in generator 1 and say let us call transformer 1. Circuit breaker 2 is protecting for any fault for this generator G2 and T2. Okay. Circuit breaker 3 and 4 are protecting in say transmission line 1, likewise line 2, line 3 and line 4. So all these symbols are loads. These are all loads connected to this one. Sir, why we are dividing our protection scheme into different zones? What advantage will we get? When you divide the protection scheme into different zones, then you are assigning the task to different circuit breakers. So here, what is the responsibility of circuit breaker 5? Circuit breaker 5 responsibility is to clear any fault that occurs in transmission line 2. So the primary responsibility of circuit breaker 5 and circuit breaker 6, primary responsibility of circuit breaker 4 and circuit breaker 5 is to protect transmission line 2. Understand? So that is why. Similarly, circuit breaker 9 and 10, the primary responsibility is to protect line 4. Okay. Suppose if the fault is occurring, say in here, three phase short circuit fault occurs exactly in between light. See how the fault current will flow. Assume here also some sources are connected. The fault current will flow like this. One fault current will flow like this. The other fault current will flow like this. Okay. Some other fault current will flow like this. Some other fault current will flow like this. So all the breakers are carrying fault currents. If you can see, all breakers are carrying the fault current. Now, if all breakers trip, what will happen? Then all the system gets open circuited. Nobody will get power supply. Nobody will get power supply. Understand? So now the fault must be cleared by which two circuit breakers, you tell me? Even though all circuit breakers are sensing the fault, circuit breaker 5 and circuit breaker 6. So if these two open, then the fault currents coming from all the sources is become zero, because now fault is isolated. Now the fault is isolated. Understand? Are able to follow? So only these two breakers are open. So nobody is getting affected, because this load is supplied like this. This load is supplied like this. Only this transmission line gets open. Okay. So in order to limit the number of elements or the number of equipment, for your understanding, the number of equipment that are disconnected by protection system during fault, the protection system is divided into number of zones. To reduce the number of equipment that are isolated during fault, we are dividing the protection system into different zones. Okay. A separate zone of protection is established around each element. So for transformer, there will be separate zone. For generator, there will be separate zone. For transmission line, there will be separate zone. Okay. Any fault in that zone will cause all the circuit breakers in that zone to trip. Okay. If a fault occurs in any one zone, suppose if the fault occurs in this zone, so how many breakers are protecting this zone? Two circuit breakers. So both circuit breakers should trip. Both circuit breakers should trip to clear that fault. Understand? The next important point is, if fault occurs in overlapping zone, suppose here if the fault occurs on this bus bar, then you tell me how many breakers should open to trip the fault. If a short circuit is occurring on this bus bar, so this, let us say this this is the short circuit fault. Then to clear the fault, which breaker should open? All the four circuit breakers will open here. That is CB1, CB2, CB3 and CB5. All these four circuit breakers will open to clear the fault. To clear the fault on this bus bar. Understand? So if the, because here the fault is occurring in the overlapping of these four zones. So if the fault occurs in the overlapping zones, more number of circuit breakers will trip. This is inevitable for safety. Okay. More number of breakers will trip if the fault occurs in the overlapping zone. There is one more overlapping zone here, you can observe. This is one more overlapping zone. Understand? So if the fault occurs in the overlapping zones, more number of breakers will trip to clear the fault. It is inevitable. This cannot be avoided, because of the safety of the system is more important. Last point for today's lecture. protection provided by each zone circuit breakers to its element is called primary protection. To its element is called primary protection. So here five lines are there. You can see here five. Now here if you see, the protection offered by circuit breaker 5 and 6, the protection offered by circuit breaker 5 and circuit breaker 6 to this transmission line 2 is called primary protection. Is called primary protection. Understand? The protection offered by the circuit breaker of that zone to that element. What is the element if they are protecting? They are protecting a transmission line 2. Here the element which they are protecting is transmission line 2. They are protecting transmission line 2. Okay. So the protection offered by CB5 and CB6 to transmission line 2 is called primary protection. Is called primary protection. Understand? Suppose because of some reason, if CB6 fails, this is not opening, because either relay malfunction, circuit breaker malfunction, some other reason it did not occur, then CB5 will open, but it will not clear the fault. Only half the currents coming from this way are restricted. If CB6 fails, then definitely there should be a backup. The CB9 should act as a backup for CB6. If it CB6 fails, it should wait some time. If CB6 doesn't trip, then CB9 should trip. CB9 should trip. Then protection offered by CB9 to this line 2 fault, it is called backup protection. It is called backup protection. Understand? So suppose this is line 2, line 1, line 3 and line 4. Okay. CB9, circuit breaker 9, it should offer primary protection, offers primary protection for which line? For line 4, because its primary responsibility is to clear any fault that is occurring in transmission line 4. That is its primary. CB9 also offers backup protection for line 2. Understand? I hope you understood the difference between the primary protection and the backup protection. The protection provided by each zone circuit breakers to its elements is called primary protection. Sometimes due to relay malfunction or failure of circuit breaker, if the fault is not cleared, then backup circuit breaker and relay should trip or should clear the fault. See, whenever there is a circuit breaker, there is a relay. Both will be there. Because the circuit diagram becomes complex, we are only showing circuit breakers. You have to remember that every circuit breaker has its own associated relay. Okay. So, when the primary protection fails, there must be backup protection for short circuit faults. For short circuit faults, because the dangers are very high, the currents are very high. So, there must be backup protection for short circuit faults. If primary protection fails, then backup protection must clear the fault. However, it should give sufficient time for primary protection to act. It should give sufficient time for primary protection to act. Within that time, if primary protection fails, then only backup protection should act. That means backup protection should act after sufficient time delay. Understand? And backup protection is a must for short circuit faults. Must for short circuit faults. Understand? So just to make you understand, suppose there is a fault here, There is a short circuit fault here. Three-phase short circuit fault. Then the protection offered by E comma F, because it is fault is occurring in this zone and E and F are the mainly responsible to clear the fault. E and F offer primary protection. So if E fails, for E backup is provided by B and D. So if F fails, for F backup is provided by G and I. So here B, D, G, I, they provide local backup protection. Local backup protection. Even if they fail, then the protection offered by A, C, H and I, this is called remote backup protection. Understand? So for the fault that is occurring here, E and F offers primary protection. For this fault where I have shown, for the fault at point P, E and F offer primary protection. B, D, G, I offers local backup protection. A, C and H, I offers remote backup protection. Understand? So backup protection is a must for short circuit faults, and it should function after sufficient time delay. How? I'll tell you. Yes. Suppose if the fault occurs here, it operates at 10 milliseconds. Or let us be very practical, it clears at 100 milliseconds. Both of them, after, suppose fault occurs at t equal to 0. So E and F should operate at 100 milliseconds. After 100 milliseconds, that is within 100 milliseconds, they should clear the fault. So here, if they don't act within this one, here they should act in 200 milliseconds. 200 milliseconds. Even if they don't, the fault is not cleared even after 200 milliseconds, this will wait till 400 milliseconds. So like this, you have to provide proper discrimination so that first chance is given to primary protection. If within its time it doesn't protect, then it waits for 200 milliseconds. And then they will act, local backup will act. Even if the fault is not cleared after 400 milliseconds, then the remote backup will act and clear the fault.